stop rushing. That's it. These are the issues that a lot of private practice owners will not share with you. They will not give you the real deal, the cons as to being in private practice. But I'm going to share with you some risks of being in private practice. Stay tuned. The first danger, or the first con, as I said, is going to be looked at as a pro, but it does have a con attached to it. And the first one is flexibility, creating your own schedule. Well, here's the thing. When you are in private practice, you may find that it's more profitable to work on weekends, to work later times, to work evening hours, to work hours that are non-traditional. So your friends, your family, your spouse, they may work a traditional 9-to-5 job where you're not working during that time. And so the time that you would have available to spend with your family or friends, you're at work. Now, this can impact your social circle, because while you're asleep or while you're at home just lounging around from the hours of 9 to 12, your family members and friends may actually be at work. You may not start your practice until later on in the afternoon or later on in the morning. Or if you are working on weekends, that's a time where the traditional 9-to-5er is off, and you may not be off because you want to meet the needs of your clients. And it proves to have more success, as a lot of people are off on the weekends and you're the only one open. So it does, again, prove to be more profitable and more successful for a private practitioner who has weekend hours and who has evening availability. So it is important to be mindful that your social circle may dwindle, or there may be some variation in the social circle that you weren't used to. Number two, in your business as a private practitioner, you have to advocate for yourself. You must do it. You are the CEO, the CFO, the janitor, the IT person, the admin person. You are the clinical director. You are everything, at least starting off when you're first getting your feet on the ground and starting a business. So you must advocate for yourself. It is not clearly outlined, the chain of command, as it might have been when you were working for another agency or so. So it's important that you advocate for yourself, and that can prove to be uncomfortable, which is why I noted it as a con or a risk or a danger or something that we don't talk about. You know, the hidden secrets of private practice and what it means for sure when you're there in the business, and you have to be the one to go ahead and take that risk and share what your concerns are, or speak up for yourself, or think about issues before they even arise, because you are ultimately the head person in charge. And I want to mention that this video is no way discouraging anyone from opening or joining a private practice. In fact, I believe that you should have all of the information necessary and the appropriate knowledge before going into a practice, such as private practice or even a group practice, because that way you're well aware of your expectations and what's going to be required of you. Look, we don't need to rush. There is plenty of time. You will get there. So I just wanted to make that clear. Number three, flexibility. Again, how flexibility can create as a con is that you are in control of your schedule. There is not a schedule created for you of 9-to-5, 10-to-6, 3-to-11. You can create your own schedule. Your supervisor isn't going to be monitoring how many times you call out, or how many tardies you had, or why you didn't show up to this place on time or to that place on time. There is none of that. You are on your own. You decide whether or not you see 5 clients a day, or 10 clients a day, or 5 a week, or 10 a week. There is no party going to be responsible for you. Now, if you're joining a private group practice, then that may prove differently, but you are the end all be all. You are in control of your schedule. And so what does that mean? That means that you have to be disciplined. You have to have a skill set of discipline that's going to catapult you to the next level, that's going to make sure that you are in line with your goals, that you're doing whatever it is necessary as far as treatment work is concerned, How many times do you have to get called out on your notes? Right now today, if you're not in private practice yet, how many times does your supervisor have to send you an email asking you when you're going to complete your notes? These are things that we have to think about. We have to think about how discipline and how consistent you will be in a practice like private practice, because you are the person. It comes all to you. And it's going to prove very much true. You're going to sure feel being a private practitioner when those notes equal payments, right? So when you complete your note, you submit your note for billing, those are things that's going to come very much in handy. And so if you're struggling already in your nonprofit or the hospital or wherever you may work, if you're struggling already with time management, or you're struggling with getting things done that you should have gotten done, that may be something to consider when you're moving towards private practice. Pay attention to your habits. Pay attention to them. Let's say you work from 8 to 5 right now, just using that as the standard time. Okay, how late do you stay up? Do you stay up to 1 or 2 in the morning and knowing you have to be up at 6 in order to make it to your job at 8, right? So thinking about what that looks like when you're in private practice. What about when you have an 8 a.m. and you're staying up until 1 or 2 in the morning? Are you disciplined enough to get up on time and to make it to your session on time? Because if you have an 8 a.m. set, you really have the authority to cancel that appointment. If you didn't feel well, or if something came up, you have the authority to do that, and it will be without penalty. At least in the sense of there's no supervisor looking over your shoulder asking what happened to that client, right? Now, an ethical or financial penalty sounds to be right, but as far as an immediate consequence to you canceling a patient or saying you're going to be 20 minutes late, there is no consequence. On the other hand, what if you don't have a client schedule? What are your habits? What does your morning still look like as a private practitioner, even though you may have a 10 a.m.? Are you going into the office only at 9? Are you going to be there at 8 a.m. making sure things are ready and in order? So these are, again, things that we need to think about. And instead, we have this fairy tale of what private practice is or should be. And that's just not accurate. It's not accurate for anyone. Private practice, successful private practices are built on hard work. On hard work. That's it. Number 4, boundaries. I went into detail about this in my last video, so check that out. I discussed and talked about boundaries in a way that we don't usually talk about. So we talk about boundaries usually in the form of being very restrictive on our treatment practices, what we disclose, what we don't disclose, things of that nature. But as far as boundaries is concerned in business, what I was talking about was the fact that as a business owner, there are going to be times where the two come together. Okay, and it may definitely have an impact and can have an impact on your daily life. There may be times where you are looking up business practices while you're at home. So I think we should have a great understanding of what boundaries can and will look like as a business owner. So what am I saying? I am saying that don't rush. You don't have to rush. Take your time. To my beginner therapist, to my therapist who are fresh out of school, or for those who are still in school, keep pushing, keep pushing. It is well worth it. But don't feel obligated to join a private practice because you saw somebody on Instagram starting a private practice and talking about their manual and talking about their free worksheet that they will give you and talking about how they turned their side hustle into a full-time income. And I get that. Okay, what I'm saying is just don't rush. Hone your skills. Improve completing your notes in 72 hours or 24 hours. Start working on that, because the sooner that you start to hone your skills, clarify what your treatment modality is, understand yourself as a practitioner, clarify your audience, see how it is that you want to be molded into your craft, Do that. Appreciate your nonprofit. Appreciate the hospital you work at. Appreciate you working at the local community center right now. It's nothing wrong with that. It's nothing wrong with that. And there shouldn't be any shame, any guilt around people who don't want to be in private practice. That's a thing too. It's not for everyone. It's a route that some can take, but it's not for everyone. And if you're an individual who does not want to go into private practice, don't. You can still be successful without private practice. I think that's not talked about enough. Okay, there are definite pros, there are definite cons on both ends, but we can all be successful in our craft, whether I choose to be in private practice and you do not. That's totally fine. Totally fine. We can all be successful in our craft. We can all be successful in the profession that we went to school for and fought so hard for. Let's not get it twisted that everyone has to be a boss out here and an entrepreneur and they have to brand themselves. Some people don't want to, and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. Know your lane and stay in that lane. Lane Wellness. As I get off my soapbox, I want to shout out my school-based counselors, my community workers, my hospital social workers, my counselors all around, those in children and family services. There are agencies that have to have people. We can't all just go to private practice. Everyone has their thing. I wanted to share with you the real deal, the cons, the dangers, the risks of private practice. It is what it is. Thank you so much for watching. Please share your thoughts on private practice. Are you interested in private practice? Are you not interested in private practice? What are some things that you are concerned about when it comes to private practice? Thank you so much for watching. I would love, love, love to hear from you all. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.